Thank you, everyone, for joining us. Good morning. Thank you for coming out in the cold. It's a very chilly day here in D.C. To join us this morning at Creating Popular Narratives, a roundtable with journalists. We're so happy to have you all join in the conversation. My name is Rebecca Kaplan, and I am the Mellon ACLS Public Fellow at the Pulitzer Center on Crisis Reporting. The Pulitzer Center promotes in-depth engagement with global affairs through its support of quality international journalism across all media platforms and an innovative program of outreach and education. Over its 11-year history, the Pulitzer Center has consistently demonstrated its commitment to shining light on critical global issues that are too often ignored. We support around 150 international reporting projects a year, partnering with a wide range of news media partners and independent journalists, including those on this panel. Education outreach is also key to our model through direct engagement in secondary schools and universities and through events like this. All of today's panel members have visited K-16 classrooms in person and via Skype, and there are free lesson plans that use their reporting as a resource available at the Pulitzer Center Lesson Builder. If you would like to talk more about education opportunities and resources, I'm happy to talk to you at any point after this panel or during the conference, or you can contact our education team by visiting pulitzercenter.org/education. I'm very excited about our panel today. As a historian at a journalism organization, I'm really interested in the overlap between what journalists do and what historians do. Moshe Temkin yesterday in the commentary not punditry panel pointed out that at the heart of it, the goal of the historian is to be a truth teller. And I think that's very much the goal of a journalist as well. Sort of at the heart of it, you have that core principle that both disciplines are engaging in, and they might do it in different ways, in different methodologies, though I see a lot of overlap in that too in my work at the Pulitzer Center. And we also talked about the panel yesterday, the fact that journalists often use historians as a source, go to them for background information. At the crowdsource syllabus panel, they also talked about using journalists as sources the other direction for creating these crowdsource and public syllabi. And I think that today, hopefully, we'll talk about an even deeper connection between the realm of journalism and history and what we can learn from each other. And so the four journalists on our panel today are all working on projects and have worked on projects in the past that require them to engage with history. And today they're going to discuss this work, how they do it, and the ways that historians and journalists can work together. This will be a conversation. We want the audience, we want you all not only asking questions, but giving comments as well. And hopefully, I think we have some questions that the panelists want to ask to you as well. And so what I'm going to do is introduce them, ask a question just to get things started off. I, of course, have many more questions I would love to ask, but at that point, I want to turn it over to you all so you have plenty of time to ask your questions and give your comments. So our first panelist, all the way down to my left at the end, is Pulitzer Center Senior Advisor Marvin Kahl. Marvin is also the Edward R. Murrow Professor Emeritus at the Harvard Kennedy School and a guest scholar at the Brookings Institute. His journalism career includes award-winning reporting for both CBS and NBC News as Chief Diplomatic Correspondent, Moscow Bureau Chief, and anchor of NBC's Meet the Press. Marvin served 25 years as Founding Director and Senior Fellow of the Joan Shorenstein Center on the Press, Politics, and Public Policy at Harvard University's Kennedy School of Government. He's also authored or co-authored numerous nonfiction books and two best-selling novels. His latest book, The Year I Was Peter the Great, is a memoir of his experience as a graduate student doing research in Moscow as part of the U.S. diplomatic mission in 1956. Next, just immediately to my left here, is Richard Bernstein, a book writer and freelance journalist who has spent more than three decades as a foreign correspondent, cultural reporter, and book critic, first for Time Magazine and then for the New York Times. He has written 9 books and contributed to magazines such as The New Republic, Foreign Affairs, and the New York Review of Books. His most recent Pulitzer Center-funded reporting is Asia in the Time of Trump, which explores the challenges and difficulties of China's rise and America's inattention on Taiwan and in Thailand. Our third panelist is Pulitzer Center grantee Thomas Van Hootrieff, whose major work interweaves investigative journalism, philosophy, and metaphor. Thomas has had solo exhibitions of his work in Paris, New York City, Barcelona, and Italy. His work has included numerous private collections and impermanent collections of the Nelson Atkins Museum of Art, the Museum of Contemporary Photography in Chicago, and the Open Society Foundation. As the current Pulitzer Center Catchlight Fellow, he is working on a photo project that imagines what the early days of the West would have looked like if photographic technology had been widely available at the time, asking the question, would a comprehensive visual record of Hispanic explorers, pioneers, and Native people help us better understand our heritage and identity today? And unfortunately, due to the weather, Danielle Zalkman can't join us today. Thankfully, Pulitzer Center grantee Allison Shelley has agreed to join us on the panel instead. Thank you very much, Allison, for filling in last minute. I think that's a common theme across a lot of panels so far this weekend. Allison is an independent documentary photographer and multimedia journalist whose work has been featured in National Geographic, The New Yorker, The New York Times, The Atlantic, Washington Post, NPR, and The Wall Street Journal. She is also the director of the Women Photographers of Washington and part of the adjunct faculty at Northwestern's Medill School of Journalism and the Corcoran School of Art and Design at George Washington University. Her longstanding work focuses on cultural barriers to maternal health for women. And so I want to throw out a very broad question for you all just to start off here, but how do you incorporate history into your reporting? And Marvin, if you could lead us off with that question.
Sure, thank you very much. In all honesty, I'm not quite sure I know where to begin. When you've been at this as long as I have, you get many examples that you can turn to and use. For me, the relationship of history to journalism is intimate. One leads into the other. Phil Graham said, the owner of the publisher of the Washington Post about 60 years ago, that journalism is the first draft of history. It is. I think the best journalists are those who know some history when they go out to cover a story. And one example, let me share with you, it goes back to August of 1964, August 2nd, as a matter of fact, the Gulf of Tonkin, off the coast of North Vietnam. An American destroyer was floating around, the North Vietnamese say, in North Vietnamese waters. The Americans claimed that it was international waters. The North Vietnamese attacked. There was an attack. Lyndon Johnson was then running for president on his own. He did not want to go to war before the presidency, the election itself, but he wanted very much to appear to be very strong, very powerful. And he was going up opposite Barry Goldwater. When the Pentagon, then led by Robert McNamara, turned to the president and said, there is definitely an attack. What do you want to do about it? He thought about it, and decided he would do nothing, but he would send another destroyer into the neighborhood, send an aircraft carrier not too far away. And on August 4th, there was said to be a second attack. The second attack, as it turned out, never happened. But on the basis of the attack that never happened, Lyndon Johnson ordered the Air Force to attack certain military installations along the coast of North Vietnam, and the war then got started in earnest. The United States Congress, the Senate, by a vote, I believe, of 98-2, if my memory is right, voted in favor of the Tonkin Gulf resolution. Anybody who had read anything about the history of Southeast Asia, anything about Chinese history, anything about what the United States was doing in that part of the world in the 1950s, anybody who had been at the Geneva Conference in 1954, anybody who had had half a brain, would have recognized that the United States, with this resolution, was saying something terribly important. The wording was very clear. Can't give it to you exact, but the idea was that the United States, on the basis of this resolution, was empowered by the Congress to take any military action it chose anywhere to fight back against those people who were attacking the United States or American interests. The administration gave many briefings at that time. The briefings indicated that it made the point that the U.S. did not want to get involved, was not involved, would hope never to be involved, wanted peace, etc. But the wording was unmistakable. Congress gave authority to the president to take military action anywhere in defense of American interests. Two news organizations at the time, the Washington Post and CBS, stressed the implied threat in the Gulf of Tonkin resolution. Murray Motter of the Washington Post and yours truly for CBS stressed the history aspect and what it is that the United States was doing at that time and setting itself up to do at that time. Very few news organizations followed that storyline. Most of them went along with the administration. And the administration led the day. Most of the organizations stressed the line that the president wanted out. For me, that was at the time and to this day, one of those moments when you knew that history was going in a different direction, and yet journalism, for whatever combination of reasons, did not convey that, and I think in that sense, failed in its coverage of the Vietnam War, really from the very beginning. We can carry on this and anything else you like, but that's just a start.
All right. Well, I'm currently working on a history-based project, as Rebecca said in the introduction. Most of my projects before that have been really about contemporary issues, sometimes with historical context. But in this case, what I wanted to look at is U.S.-Mexican border, specifically how it was before 1848. And since I'm a photographer, I initially got interested in photography history. That was sort of my entry point into history. And as I was doing research, I discovered that there were many, many photographs taken directly after the U.S. took over what's today called the American West, but used to be half of Mexico, starting in 1849 with the gold rush, for example. There were 12 daguerreotypists who moved to San Francisco. And so we have pictures of everything after U.S. takeover, railroads arriving, gold miners, cowboys. So we have this kind of iconic visual archive of the American West. Before that, I can't find any single photograph. And it just appears that photographic technology did not arrive in time to capture the Spanish and Mexican periods of the West, which actually started long before many of us imagined. There are historians in this room, but these are strange things that I discovered along the way that weren't taught to me in school or did seem to be part of common knowledge. That, for example, the first church in the continental United States is in Santa Fe, New Mexico, and it was erected before Plymouth Rock, before the Mayflower landed. That I also, it seems like there's a lot of historical scholarship on the Civil War, but if you go a few years back to the Mexican-American War, it doesn't seem to be taught as much. And so during this project, I also learned that Thoreau's civil disobedience and how that phrase was coined was for not paying taxes for the Mexican-American War, and that also President Lincoln is a first-term congressperson had campaigned against the Mexican-American War, and even Ulysses S. Grant, who was an officer in it, was also against the Mexican-American War. So at the time, the Mexican-American War is very controversial, and today we're talking about the border incessantly, but it seems like we don't talk about the history of it anymore. And so I saw that overlap with the winners, I guess, write the history about the Mexican-American War, and then you have this missing visual history. And so I thought, how could I sort of bring that back, and how would it be easier for people to remember? So what I did is I live in Paris, and I bought a 19th century wooden camera, and I learned how to make wet plate photographs, like in the mid 19th century, and I traced the old border line. The top of Alta California all the way into Wyoming, part of Wyoming used to be in Mexico, and then down through the middle of the Rockies, and then all the way out along the Red River to the Louisiana-Texas border. So I took physical pictures. If Mexicans at the time had photographic technology, we would have had a visual record of that. Instead, 1 to 10 years later, we start getting a visual record of the West taken completely by Anglophone people. And then I identified people that I wanted to take portraits of. Those are people who are direct descendants of families would have been in the United States since before 1848. So I identified Native American and Hispanic people who have been here since before that time and took their portraits. And when you see the finished photograph, since it has the aesthetics and texture of the time, you sort of tripped into initially thinking that these are historical photographs. But I didn't set things up and stage them perfectly, so you might see somebody has a modern polo shirt or something like that, a little bit out of focus. And so it forces you to ask questions. And I grew up in California. The way that I was taught history in school was they only teach you about early California history in the fourth grade. And from then on, it's gold rush forward. You learn in the fourth grade how to build a Spanish mission out of, I believe it's sugar cubes and popsicle sticks. And then you're done with early California history. I think today when we're talking about the Hispanic tissue or nature of the far west and the immigration issues, it would be really important to have that historical context into the dialogue of the reporting. I mean, I've heard so much about the wall, so much about immigration, and so little about the historical context.
So when I was preparing to speak today, I was thinking about how historians and journalists are so similar, right? Everything has a history. I think that's one of the themes that you guys actually have on the AHA website. And that's what I think about too when I do my stories, right? Everything has a history. History is the foundation for every story I do. And while my pieces may not be overtly, you know, connected to history in that way, as I was reflecting back on the things I do, I realized that everything does connect, and it's important for us as journalists to connect to that history. If we forget, you know, to connect that piece that we're doing with our stories about present news, present issues, we miss so much of the context, so much of the important lessons that we're trying to be showing to people, right? So a few of the stories that came to mind, what I do, I spent a lot of time in the country of Haiti. I moved there after the earthquake in 2010, lived there for a couple of years. And Haiti is a curious place. I'm sure many of you know some of the complicated history of that nation, but it's one of the oldest countries in this region. You know, it got its independence in 1802, and then spent a lot of time paying money back to France for the privilege of being independent. So it had a pretty rocky foundation, which we don't always remember when we're thinking about the poverty of this country and how, you know, the evolution of this place. One of the big stories I'm doing right now, and I've been working on for several years, involves a community that did not exist before the earthquake. It was it's being built up in a piece of on a piece of land that was completely vacant, right outside of Port-au-Prince, and it was basically declared the government took eminent domain over it, and people have been moving there. There are about 200,000 people living there now, not being supported by any government programs. There are no official roads. There is no running water. There is no electricity. And you might imagine that in this context, you would have a slum, as you might expect in other places that already exist in this region. But people have decided to kind of rewrite their own history in this place and have really come together and decided, no, we're going to form community groups. We're going to make real roads so that cars can get through. We're going to build our own utility poles. We are going to pay for water trucks to come in and fill basins so we can actually have water, and we're going to make our own community. And if you didn't know the history of this place, if you didn't know what an awesome feat that was, you would miss out on a lot of that understanding. So I've been going back and forth trying to document the evolution of a city, essentially. They say it's going to be one of Haiti's biggest cities in just a few years. So watching this place evolve, to me, is just having my eyes on history as it's occurring and sort of fast forward. Another story that I've done there that I actually did for National Geographic was a contrast piece. So I did spent a lot of time there in 2010 documenting the damage done by the quake and recovery efforts and things different people were doing to try to clean up. And I went back 5 years later on the anniversary and I photographed the very same spots 5 years later. What has happened? Has anything been cleaned up here? In a lot of cases, the answer was no. In a lot of cases, the answer was a little bit. But then some of the places, things had been done. But what does that look like? So again, history happening, occurring, like keeping our minds on how does history unfold? And that's one of my favorite things.
Well, good morning. I always wanted that cleanup. There are three people on base that are really very interesting, all of them. When I first heard about the topic, I thought that it was so axiomatic, so fundamental, that a journalist, in order to be any good, has to know some history, that I never even thought about it. I just took it for granted, just assumed that would have to be the case, and so therefore would have nothing to say about it because I never really reflected on it at all. But this has, the occasion does cause me to reflect a little bit about it. So I mean, in the post, I mean, especially I've worked both in the United States and abroad, but the more memorable experiences in my career were the postings that I had as a foreign correspondent for a Time magazine and for the New York Times. I was 4 years in Hong Kong in the days before we had normal diplomatic relations with China, so that I was a China watcher and I covered Southeast Asia and sort of the aftermath of the Vietnam War that Marvin talked about. I then went to China. I was there for 3.5 years living in Beijing. It was a different China, but a China that's also quite distressingly the same as the China of today. I then was 4 years in France as the New York Times Paris correspondent, and I finished my career as a foreign correspondent in Berlin, where I covered Germany and the former Eastern European countries. And in all of those, again, as I say, it was axiomatic that if you didn't know at least some of the fundamentals of the history of those countries and those regions, you just absolutely couldn't do the job. And so naturally, I not only tried to do a little bit of historical reading, but I interviewed historians, and it was important to me as a journalist that I have sources among historians that I could call on to help me understand current events in light of the past. in order to understand what's on the minds of the people that you're covering and that you're trying to explain to your readership or your viewership, you have to know the history that they're coming from. To make an example, I thought maybe I would try to pick up on some of what Marvin was talking about. By the way, he's a historical figure himself, and now, you know, the journalism enters into the history, and no better example than the Vietnam War. I mean, we've just had the movie, The Post, which is about unfairly giving credit to the Washington Post instead of the New York Times, but we won't dwell on that in the case of the Pentagon Papers. But the wonderful example that you bring up of the Gulf of Tonkin resolution and the failure of both journalists and maybe more importantly, the Johnson administration to understand the history of Chinese-Vietnamese relations and how unlikely it was, would have been that Vietnam would have subjected itself to a kind of Chinese control in a unified global enterprise in order to spread communism and to destroy liberal democracy. The Chinese, the deeper you go into Vietnamese history in particular, not that I've gone into it that deeply, but at least I got into it deeply, that deeply, you know that all of the heroes of Vietnamese history are resistors to Chinese influence and to Chinese rule. And the fact that nobody knew that, or maybe I shouldn't say nobody, I don't know nobody, but very few of the journalists and very few of the policymakers in the Johnson administration, and even before then in the Kennedy administration, appreciated the depth, the way in which China, as a kind of pernicious and negative and threatening force, was in the collective mind of the Vietnamese people, and that by going to war against Vietnam, we were in a way sort of pushing the Vietnamese into an opposite direction from the one they had been going into for most of their history. And you know, you could, all of the countries that I've reported on, you could say more or less the same thing. When I was in Berlin, living in Berlin, I traveled a lot to Poland. I used to love to go to Poland because in Germany, which is where, you know, the main country that I was supposed to be covering, by the time I got there, a lot of the obvious historical issues that the Germans wrestled with and they continue to wrestle with, and if, for example, you can't understand Angela Merkel's response to the migrant crisis in Germany without understanding something of German history. We all know, and this is a kind of an obvious point, and I think you have to know more history than the obvious, but obviously Germans responded to the need of people to find a refuge in a different way from most European countries because of the burden of guilt that the Germans feel in connection with World War II. In Poland, though, I always felt that the historical issues were somehow more urgent, were less settled. And I remember I came across a story of a woman who was sort of the spokeswoman for the Solidarity Trade Union movement, who had been accused by the Commission on Historical Remembrance of having secretly collaborated with the communist and martial law regime. And I went I spoke to the commission and saw their evidence, and then I went to visit this woman who was deeply fraught and deeply vexed and emotional about this accusation, which she maintained was absolutely false. Well, I wasn't in a position to adjudicate who was right and who was wrong in this issue, but I certainly think that I was able to approach the story in a deeper way, not only by understanding the immediate background in Poland, Soviet domination and then the collaborationist martial law regime that spent a lot of time trying to suppress the Solidarity Trade Union movement, which eventually triumphed after the fall of the Soviet Union. But sort of the deeper issues in the Polish collective mind, the fact that Poland for more than 100 years didn't exist as a country, was occupied by Austria, Germany, and Russia. And if you don't know that about Poland, you couldn't have understood quite the depth of the emotion that this charge against the supposed heroine of the Solidarity Trade Union movement had. And then, you know, beyond that, to try to understand a little bit about what did it mean to collaborate in that era? What sorts of compromises would have been acceptable and what sorts of compromises would not have been acceptable? Living in a happy, or at the moment not so happy, liberal democracy like the United States, we Americans are rarely called upon, if ever, to face that kind of an issue. The worst that can happen to us is that an editor doesn't like a story or you have a disagreement about some aspect of coverage. But there's never life and death questions. There's no possibility of imprisonment because of your point of view. We aren't called upon to make the choice between a little bit of collaboration in exchange for a degree of freedom. We don't have to know where to draw the line because there is no line for us. But if you understand a little bit of history in a place like Poland, you understand the importance of that line and how and where it can be and what's acceptable for it to be. That informs the sort of writing. That informs a sort of interpretation. The approach that I took was to feel a kind of deep sympathy for both sides of this issue. I kind of assumed that the Commission on National Memory, I'm sorry, I don't even remember the exact name of it, was right about this former spokeswoman. She's a very beautiful, glamorous looking woman. She was really a kind of the la passionaria of the Solidarity movement, tremendously important at that time, so that for her to be accused of having collaborated was deeply shocking to Poland and to her. And I tried to find some reasons. She denied it. I kind of wished, when I had a long, long conversation with her, that she would have admitted it a little bit and described to me exactly what the situation was and why it was necessary for her to collaborate in the way that she did, the way that I think that she did. But I still, even in the absence of that, I understood the moral complexity of the issue. For me, it wasn't a simple question, and I think it was important for me that it not be a simple issue. And one last point I wanted to get back to the Vietnam War and to what Martin said about that. There's also, Phil Graham talked about journalism as the first draft of history. I don't know who it was who said that a little knowledge is a dangerous thing. I think that there's also a danger of a little bit of knowledge on the part of journalists and maybe on the part of everybody. We might think that we understand, but what we're really doing is taking a couple of very simple messages or a couple of simple analogies to the past. And one of the mistakes about Vietnam was that we applied the wrong historical analogy. We, the United States of America, we thought that the applicable analogy was the Munich Agreement and an appeasement of Nazi Germany. And that's what pushed us to, even as far back as the French, and our decision to help the French to reestablish colonial control over Vietnam, was that if we didn't do that, the Western alliance against Soviet expansionism would be weakened. And therefore, we had, even though it was somewhat distasteful to us to help restore a colonial empire, we had to do it for the sake of the emerging Western alliance. Otherwise, we were in danger of repeating history, repeating the history of the Nazi invasions of Europe. So we applied the Munich analogy to Vietnam. We did it in Korea also, I think, in that sense, correctly, and from my point of view, all these many decades later. But in Vietnam, it was the wrong analogy. In Vietnam, the correct analogy was decolonization, that the Vietnamese were part of a long historical movement by which what we call the Third World in those days sought independence, dignity, and equal standing with the former colonial oppressors. And so we misinterpreted history. It wasn't that we ignored it. It was that we had a little bit of knowledge, and it turned out in the case of Vietnam to be a dangerous thing.
If you have a question, please go up to the mic just so we're sure we get it on camera too.
Good morning. My name is Audra Wolf. I'm a historian and writer, so I dabble in writing for more popular things and kind of do on the edges of what looks like regular history and sometimes some other kinds of writing. So I'm wondering if we could take this in a slightly more practical direction. I'm hearing a lot about. I'm so glad to know that you guys incorporate history into your work. That's fantastic. It's interesting hearing you talking about how you're using history, because the ways that you're talking about it sound like, you know, often what historians do. You're reading relevant secondary sources. You're trying to develop. You're recognizing that the past is a complicated moral place and developing empathy for your people and getting a lot of context. That's certainly what historians do. And you know, some historians, when they're writing about the past, are also trying to explore aspects of material culture or putting themselves in places or walking their way through it, which is what journalists do. So I guess one way to ask this question would be to ask you, what do you see as the fundamental difference in historical methods versus journalistic methods when you're writing about the past?
I'm going to repeat because I think some folks up here that just really lean into the mic, I think.
It is on? Okay. Here we go. There we go. I do know how to use a mic. I just couldn't get it out. Okay, so if we're thinking about the ways that historians can use some more journalistic techniques or ways, you know, the journalists are thinking about the past, there's a lot of ways to get at that question, but I think maybe a very specific, practical way to get at what historians and journalists can learn from one another would be to think about, I would love to hear from what you see as the fundamental difference between historical methods and journalistic methods when you're writing about the past, right? Because a lot of how you're talking about incorporating history into your work, the things that you're describing look like what historians do when they write about the past, right? You get to know the secondary sources, you try to develop empathy for the characters, you understand that the past is a complicated place, you know, and a lot of these kinds of things. And historians some historians, when they are writing about the past or adopting some things that feel more like journalism, they're going to places, they're trying to use the devices, or, you know, the historians do these things too. So I'm wondering if you could just say a little bit about what you see as the fundamental difference between historical methods and journalistic methods when you're writing about the past.
I could just try to answer your question. What is a journalistic approach and a historical approach? Journalism deals with the present most of the time. You're dealing with what is happening or what happened in the recent past. So what is available to study depends on the technology of the moment, what is available. When you are studying something in the distant past, your tools for analysis are more limited. Not necessarily, but more limited. I would like to say that both the journalistic and the historical approach will depend on primary sources. Your own eyes, your own ears for a journalist are absolutely essential tools. For the historian going further back, The eyes are for the examination of documents. What kind of documents do you have? Where do you go? Is it better for you, for example, to read a diary than it is to read an historical analysis of something that happened 500 years ago? It depends on the kind of historian you are. There are historians I know who are masterful at evoking the spirit, the feel of the time, give you a sense that you were there. Those who wrote about the American Revolution and American great American characters of 200-300 years ago wrote about them using all of the tools at their discretion, all of the tools that were available. My own gut feeling is that maybe as I go on, I'm thinking that both are attempting to tell a story. How do you tell a story? There are some people who are awfully good at it. Don Hewitt, who started 60 Minutes, would always tell a reporter when you came in with a great story, you were absolutely convinced it was a front page story. And he would look at me and he would say, Martin, tell me a story. Tell me what happened. And then you suddenly realize that it depends on how you approach the story, the way in which, what it is that you want to bring out. My own tendency is to go with what people say, where they live, what they look like. If I can interview them, I feel very good about that. If I can't, what is it that they said to other people? I'm less comfortable with government documents, increasingly, as a matter of fact, as I go and write about, say, American history in the last 100 years. I find more and more that a reliance on government documents is misleading. Again, picking up the Vietnam War. My experience with that is that if you were to deal with specific documents, you'll get a government narrative, and that's part of the story, and you have to report that. But it may not give you an actual feel or picture of what was happening at that time. Lyndon Johnson, in 1964, walked around for most of the year with a copy of the resolution in his pocket. He knew he was going to have something that he could take to the American people and say, I am hereby justified in taking military action against the bad guys. In his mind, it was a political necessity to write about Lyndon Johnson without understanding where he came from in Texas, what his mindset was to miss the whole point of how he approached the Vietnam War. They weren't connected because it was all an expression of one American politician's vision of America's national security interest. Quite often, as a matter of fact, I am repelled by government documents, and that turned against them. You want to read them, they do provide one aspect of the story, but far from the most important. I always go back to people, to leaders, where they came from, what they represented, in order to provide your reader with a feel for the time that was real. Government documents aren't real. They're written by bureaucrats to protect themselves, or to protect their boss. A depressing experience is to read when there was an attempt on the Pope's life in 1981, there were any number of ways you could have covered that story. If you listen to what the Russians said, or you listen to what Western diplomats said, who wanted to maintain good, easy relations with the Soviet Union, best you could, you would not get anywhere near
was asked in English history, ask it again in modern European history.
Who and why? Again, if you went to the State Department, the British Foreign Office, the French, you would get stories that were simply fairy tales. Why in God's name, they asked, would the Russians ever take action against the Pope? They would never do anything that reckless. Well, read some of the stuff, and they would. I'm going on, forgive me, but the question you raise is so fundamental on finding the link between journalism and history and applying it to the writing of history. What is the best way of doing it? We'll all do it in our own way. I'm only saying that I have learned over the years that the more I depend on government documents, the further away I am from conveying the truth to the people.
Can I stop that one, actually? I see you were, can we get back to you in a minute? What I said at the beginning about the issue being so axiomatic that I hadn't really reflected on it very much, I think we as journalists probably do the same thing that ordinary, non-journalists do, which is we read books. I don't think very many of us subscribe to the scholarly journals. We're not at that level of specialization. But we do read the basic important books, or at least one or two of them, on the countries that we cover. It's not mysterious. I think that's probably where most of us get our history, just by reading what new people write. And then some of us, after we get too old to be journalists anymore, we become historians. And I actually have an interesting example. I think it's a little bit analogous to what Marvin has been saying. My last book was called China 1945, and it was a narrative of the few months before the end of World War II and the few months after World War II, the relationship among China, the United States, and the Soviet Union. And it sort of tries to answer the question, could the outcome, which was hostility between China and the United States, been any different if the United States had followed a wiser policy. And one of the really, I thought, gripping moments in 1945, actually it began in 1944, in my book, 1945 started in September 1944, and it ended in April 1946. That was 1945. For that much of that period, American journalists and American diplomats were able to go to Yan'an, the communist base area where Mao Zedong had his refuge during World War II, and was able, behind enemy lines, to build up the force that ended up in communist control of all of China. And the enemy of Mao was the nationalist regime led by Chiang Kai-shek. And the journalists went to Yan'an, and they had wonderful access, or they thought they had wonderful access. They were able to talk to Mao and to the other senior leaders of the communist revolution. They attended the Saturday night dance parties, and they visited them in the homes, in the caves, where they lived. And they wrote these really kind of rhapsodic reports about what a great place this Yan'an was, how refreshing it was, how bracing it was compared to the corrupt, miasmic atmosphere of Chongqing, which was the wartime capital of the nationalists. And these reports actually were echoed by some of the diplomats, including the best China experts that we had at that time. Their names are John Patton Davis. They're called the Four Johns: John Patton Davis, John Stuart Service, John Vincent, and John K. Fairbank. But our view now, the view that a historian, and they were great people, by the way, they were brave, they were courageous, they were smart, they were not left-wing in particular, they weren't fomenting a communist revolution, they were later accused in the McCarthy period of having consciously sabotaged the nationalist government and promoted the communist takeover of China, and especially in the State Department, many careers were destroyed because of the reporting that they did, because of the atmosphere and the reporting that they did. So it became kind of a difficult moral question, in a way, to write about that. On the one hand, I admired them, and I don't think that if I had been there at the time, I would have done any better. On the other hand, I felt that they made really fairly cataclysmic mistakes. They got the story very wrong, because the communists were very, very clever at showing them a particular side of themselves. During that entire period from 1942 to 1944, what we know now is that a vicious ideological purge was taking place within the communist ranks that prefigured the Cultural Revolution of the later time, the 1960s. The journalists and the diplomats had no knowledge of what was going on behind the scenes, that this was a movement, a proto-totalitarian movement that was building Mao up as a kind of demigod whose judgment and role couldn't be questioned by anybody, and that anybody who raised even the slightest doubt or slightest criticism would be subject to horrendous reprisals, the sort of mobilization of the whole movement, the press, the propaganda machinery, the military, the bureaucracy, everything would be mobilized against that single individual. And this was completely unknown to the journalists and the diplomats who went to Yan'an and covered it at the time. So how could they have known? I don't think they could have known. But now we can know. So, you know, the journalistic account has value in its vividness and its being on the scene. But in that particular instance, I think the journalists got a lot of it basically wrong. And it's up to the historians now to correct that record and to analyze why it was that the journalists and the diplomats got it wrong.
Yes, Mike, if you could come up to the mic, just so we can all hear you.
Talk so long, I almost forgot what I wanted to say.
I'm sorry, I'll be so long.
I teach at a very large public institution in Texas. Actually, I have a couple of comments to make, as well as a couple of questions. My first impression is someone who's talked American history for four decades. Is this not on?
Yeah, just make it right in front of your mouth.
As someone who's taught at a large public institution, American history and African American history for four decades, what struck me, among other things, is that some of the best histories have been written by journalists. They've been revised, to be sure, like other historians. And I thought immediately of some of the books that I've used over the course of my career, particularly upper level graduate courses. Taylor Branch's work, for example, on civil rights. David Haberstand's wonderful history of foreign policy in the Clinton administration. John Hersey's Hiroshima, as it's pronounced today. Elizabeth Drew's Marvin, Watergate, Washington Journal. I could go on and on and on. But it seems to me also that historians and journalists have different objectives. Be sure they're both trying to get at the truth, you know, paraphrase civil rights Mills to objectively end the lectures, tell the truth, expose the lies. But journalists don't have the luxury, it seems to be, of years of deliberation, right? They're trying to get the story out quickly, sometimes perhaps too quickly. But historians can take a decade, many decades, to try to write the story. I also wanted to comment, but I'll let other people comment on Marvin's comment about not trusting government documents. But it also made me think of recent forms of communication, email, for example, Twitter, government documents, as you know, can be suppressed. Look at how the Kennedy administration, for example, the assassination records are being released now in sort of selectively in droves. So I wanted you to comment on that. Historians also, journalists, of course, interview people. Historians now have increasingly drawn upon oral histories. And as many of you know, either in this room or on the panel, some of the best histories of slavery have relied upon those oral histories that were done by John Lomax and his group in the 1930s, and they continue to be really very, very critical. But it seems to me also that writing contemporary history, which I'm trying to do in my own work on Blacks in the West, you really do have to draw heavily upon journalists, oral histories, historians, and I'm having more trouble utilizing more recent forms of communication, whether it's email, that kind of thing, is clearly not readily accessible to historians. So again, some comments, some questions for all of you to think about. But it seems to me, with the exception of long-form journalism, which most journalists, it seems to me, who write for daily newspapers really just don't have the luxury of the long years of deliberation that historians have.
One of the things I hope we get to talk about is, especially as many historians are trying to do more public-facing work, is sort of the rapid turnaround nature of, you know, writing for the public, and that's something journalists certainly have much more experience with.
I just wanted to add one more thing to that conversation that Marvin started to talk about with saying that you have to have a story as a journalist. Let's say I come from the visual perspective as a photographer, but if you're looking at how photographs are used in history, often it's just about archiving and getting things so you can find them. To use it in journalism, you have to place the photographs in a narrative arc. They have to tell a story. Just having sort of an assembly of pictures doesn't work to get it to the public. And I have little kids now, so you realize once you have little kids, the best way to get to them is by telling them a story, right? They don't take in data points. And I think when you're speaking to the general public, popular things, you have to get things in a narrative format, a story format.
My name is Ed Russell. I'm at Boston University, and I want to thank you all for coming. It's actually quite a thrill to see people in person that I've watched on television and read and admired for many years. I'd like to extend the theme we've been working about with, which is similarities between journalism and history and the way in which they can reinforce each other. And I'd like to talk specifically about audience. I'm a believer that every piece of writing, the author should know who the intended audience is and what will reach that person. And so I've published a number of history books. My audience, in my mind, has been historians. I'm now in the midst of researching a new project that might have wider appeal. It's about the Transcontinental Telegraph of 1861. And I would like to ask you about two questions. One is, how do you think of your audience for serious journalism, which you all practice? And then what do you think about how to reach that one? We've heard some, which is have a story, but I'm also interested in some more depth in that. So how do you picture your audience, and how do you think about the way you need to pitch it in order to reach that audience? Now, of course, I know I can't assume specialized knowledge. These are intelligent people, but not necessarily trained in depth in that. But I'm interested in going in more depth, if you could, in answer to that. Thank you.
I think a great danger is to try to divide up your audience into those people's, I don't think you meant this, but let me just put it in simplistic terms. Those people smart enough to understand what I'm trying to express, and those people who are really smart, and they're on my level, and I will talk to them. I think when you begin to divide up an audience, you're gonna miss the mark. Everybody is interested in a story. Everybody. Thomas was talking about his kids. I can talk about my grandkids. They're all interested in stories, and I am too. How do you tell a story? That relates to your skill as a storyteller. And some people can do it, obviously, better than others. David McCullough has a way of taking detail and bringing it to life. He lives his detail. He takes it very seriously. He spends weeks trying to find a very small item that, as a reporter, I would probably dismiss. But there's something about him as both a reporter at the very beginning, but for most of his life as a historian, that appreciates the value of every fact that you put down and the way in which you relate those facts. And for me, time and time again, I was hired by a guy named Ed Murrow. I have been in the midst now of writing, I'm in the midst of a book about, which I'm calling Enemy of the People, that it relates to the president's, this president's approach to the press. There was a great conflict between Murrow and McCarthy in 1954. Murrow could have told the McCarthy story in many different ways. What he chose to do in a half-hour program was spend 22 minutes of allowing McCarthy to speak. Murrow did not get in the middle of it. All he said was, McCarthy and our relations with China. And McCarthy spoke. And McCarthy spoke for 22 minutes, and then Murrow came in with a minute and a half conclusion, in which he wrapped it up. It was a historic broadcast because it began the demolition of the McCarthy mystique. It was then picked up by the Army McCarthy hearings, but it started with Murrow in March of 1954. And his approach to the telling of a story, let this guy tell it himself. Let me, using clips of him speaking, show you, the American people, not the smart ones and the not so smart ones, just you, what it is that this guy said, how he said it, and you respond to that. He could have done it any number of other ways, but that's the way he chose, and it was brilliant. I think you tell different stories in different ways. If he had done a classic documentary on McCarthy, it might not have had the impact. When Murrow did that, I happen to have these things in my mind because I'm writing it now. It wouldn't normally. But in early March of 1954, McCarthy, according to Gallup, had 46% of the American people, 46%, believing that except for Ike, he was the most popular Republican in the country. 2 weeks after the Murrow broadcast, it was 32%. So it had a powerful impact. But it was his way of telling a story. And each one is different, each story is different, each teller is different. I don't think there are locked in patterns that must be followed. You were going to do it different from the way I would do it. But there is a way of telling a story. I think every now and then a writer ought to sit down and talk to himself and ask simply, what am I trying to say? Not who am I saying it to? What am I trying to say, and what is the best way of saying it? For some stories, the Murrow approach was classic and great, but it might not have worked with other stories. It's a variable. It's a creative variable, and we each play with it in our own way.
Just quickly, speaking to the idea of audience, I think audience is a huge thing. It's one of the main factors that I think about. When, even as a photographer, when I am photographing my subjects, one of the main questions that I think about is, would this person be proud to have this picture appear in a publication or in an exhibition in their own community? And that often changes the way I interact and photograph people, right? And that also, and then on the other end, when things are being published, published or things are coming out, you know, who is my audience? What am I trying to say to them? What is the culture that I'm speaking to? I did a big project on the perception of the stigma of abortion in Nigeria, where it's incredibly stigmatized. And the first you know, way that it came out was I was asked to speak on radio in Lagos about this project, because I spent a lot of time there. And so just even conceiving of how to speak to this, you know, about this very stigmatized topic within the culture of that, you know, within the context of that culture was really tricky, just knowing the words to use and how to express it. And then once I was back in the United States, I've been asked by the Pulitzer Center to bring, you know, this reporting into schools. So I've been brought into schools from like high school level, junior high level, and the other week, a third grade classroom, right? The story shifted each time I told it, because you can speak about certain things to high schoolers that you cannot speak to third graders about in the same way, right? So thinking about how to tell these things, and I'm sure this is something that all of you also think about, how to relate the histories that you're learning to the audience that you're thinking about. And I think that's one of the most critical pieces of what we do. Just want to make that.
There's another aspect of this, I don't know whether you were thinking about this one, raising the question of audience. But one of the things you have to think about is that I completely agree with Marvin that you write for, you know, you don't try to divide up your audience and tone your voice down for one audience or another. But you are writing for several audiences when you write, especially, I mean, at a place like CBS or the New York Times, which are global institutions and have a lot of importance and influence. You're also writing for the government of the country that you're reporting on. And when you're in a dictatorship, what you write can influence your sources in a very negative way. Actually, my last Pulitzer Center grant was, as Rebecca said, I was in Taiwan and Thailand. And in Thailand, I was writing about the perpetuation of the martial law regime. And I felt that I had to be careful in how I identified the people that I was talking to, because they could get into deep trouble with the martial law regime. And that always creates a little bit of a tension for a journalist, because the more you can identify your sources, the more credibility your story will have, because somebody can be held accountable. I mean, I'm generally speaking in the United States an enemy of the anonymous quote. Anybody can make up a quote and attribute it anonymously, and I have a feeling that that might happen a little more than we think it does. But if you name your source, then you can't make something up, because that person can hold you accountable. In this instance, the government can hold people accountable for what they tell you as a journalist, and that can have a kind of deforming effect on the way you present an issue. It's a difficult moral question that perhaps historians don't confront anything like that, because they're writing about the past and they're dealing with public records. We're dealing with people talking, and maybe they'll say, well, but don't put this in your story. People love to talk, and one of the tricks of the journalist trade is just to get people to talk. Because once they get started, they'll sort of lose some of their hesitation and sense of discretion, and they'll tell you stuff. That happens on the government side, it happens on the non-government side. But then you have to decide morally whether you're going to report what they tell you, and can it be, even if you don't mention their name, can it be traced back to them? And if it is traced back to them, will they get into trouble, and therefore should you put it into your story or not? It's not an easy one when you're writing in countries that are not democracies.
Something that we've found that's been very useful in engaging the public at the Pulitzer Center is digital projects. And so I'd encourage you all to think about We've had reporters who've looked at cholera in Haiti and cholera in New York in the mid-19th century and decided to do that as a digital mapping project that people could interact with. Or we have a larger project called Roadkill about road safety across the world, which again, these digital mapping projects. We've been doing a lot of e-books, which are real books. They have ISBN numbers. You know, you can get them on Amazon or whatever, maybe. But thinking about digital products and the new technologies as a way to engage the public and get information out there in a more timely manner than maybe traditional distribution streams that historians use.
Hi, my name is Audrey Bastian, and I'm a writer, not a historian. Well, I'm a historian by training in school, so my academic training is my writing training academic. But I try to keep my foot in both worlds. And this is going to be my first book I've worked on in 5.5 years. I do a lot of articles and journals. I write for scholarly journals as well, but this is my first book, so I'm excited to get your sense. One of the things that I've been told when I'm in the writing community with, you know, and there's more journalists in the writing community, is that, so the question is about sourcing. They think I oversource. They think it's just totally filled with footnotes and way too detailed, and I'm hyper concerned, because when you're writing for a journal, obviously a scholarly journal, you cannot put anything out there that's not very sourced. And so my writing compatriots are telling me that that's way overdone and that I should just assume that, you know, people can find some of this stuff on their own. But my biggest concern, so the question is kind of about that push and pull between being really accurate and being more storytelling and not densing up the page with stuff. And of course, we're gonna put out the end notes for some of that sourcing, but still, so that's the general question. But the real thing that comes down to is stuff that you've already talked about, which is sometimes I review books for a review site here in DC, and I often have to go back, and a lot of these books are really great books and they tell great stories, but they're absolutely, they're perpetuating myths that we come here to historical societies and historical associations and have to fix. And of course, nobody's listening because they only read the books that are full of myths. And I think a lot of those come into, especially, maybe it's because I'm writing about Asia and the Middle East, so I see a lot of that coming out in the Middle East and Asia. So we perpetuate these ideas about the Middle East and Asia, and then we, you know, people make policies and vote on certain things because of these stories. So they're great stories, they're just not, and there's people out there in the history, you know, right here in this conference, who know the real stories, but because we're so worried about making a story that people will read, we miss out on some things that are perpetuating themselves in books that people read. So there's people that know the details and people that read the stories that are myths. And so I'm trying to understand how to make that work. So I guess it's a two-part question. What are your thoughts about that? But also, how would I, now that I have a chance to do this, source my book so that it's interesting but not over the top, which is what people are telling me can I do. You know, I'm doing that. So.
Yeah, finding that balance, right, between, you know, again, what a historian does, what a journalist does, and that we do communications, global health communication workshops for folks in global health about how to talk to the public. And, you know, one of the things the journalists point out there is, like, you might see one quote from someone or, you know, a piece of information online, and you don't understand that the journalist has done, you know, hours of research, and there's, you know, 30 more sources behind that. Like, you know, that's something that they, you know, negotiate as part of, you know, their writing, is that learning how to do that. If bringing all that knowledge into one sentence, the citation. And that's just, I think, a skill that, you know, you have to develop and work on. And there's no formula for finding the balance, unfortunately, that, you know, everyone approaches it in very different ways, and all of our journals approach it in very different ways, but that journalists, you know, I think it's in part journalists and, you know, people who are teaching students about journalism need to remind people that there are facts and figures that are behind all of this and sources behind all of it that they don't see. And so we just have, that's part of sort of media education and literacy that we need to do a better job on.
Well, but if that's if it's correct, but what if it's not?
Well, and I think that's where it's important for historians to engage in public-facing journalism. So after we happened to just by coincidence, right around when the Las Vegas shootings happened, we were, already had a scheduled symposium on gun violence that one of our journalists was part of at Boston University School of Public Health. And one of the things that came out of that is, how do you address the myth about the history of guns in the United States, particularly in the West, and the narrative that's perpetuated a lot of reporting about, you know, oh, this is a, you know, an American cultural phenomenon, and, you know, we, guns are what tamed the West, and, you know, that narrative, which historians have done such a good job at breaking down, but moving it into the media space. And I think that's why it's essential for historians to not just serve as a source for reporters, but to, and that's at that moment where we need someone who has specialized in that to write the op-ed that's going to be in the New York Times, or, you know, get in front, you know, go on a news program and talk about, well, this is actually the research that we have, this is what, you know, academics are discussing, and this is what we, you know, are talking about, what actually happened in the West, and the actual relationship and history of guns in the United States, and to start to help take apart that myth and narrative. So that's where I think historians have a duty to the American public to actually talk to with people and not just within academic circles.
Just to follow up on the footnotes and sourcing versus putting things out there, so one comment is just that credibility is earned over time, or you can get it linked through big media associations. And so if you work at a big newspaper, for example, the footnotes are there, but they're sort of with your editor, right? If there's something, the editor, if there's something in the story that looks like it needs sourcing, the editor will ask you about it, and it might get cut out of the final story for space, but somebody at the newspaper knows it, so it doesn't just go out into the wild without it. If you're not working with an editor or a big media organization behind you, then your credibility, I guess, is on the line. And so it's like, if your first book is full of inaccuracies, then your second one will be judged to be also. But I would imagine you will need less and less sourcing and footnotes as you gain credibility, either
to linking up with another publisher or media company. So in 2018, if we can maybe just focus on the United States, which public narratives about the American past do each of you think are the most dangerous, the most anti-democratic? So like today and now, which public narratives do you individually have the most moral urgency to challenge today, and how, you know, and how can historians and journalists work together to challenge those narratives? So if you could just identify that, preaching, if you could.
For me, it's us and them. And this is a theme that has run through American history, and we find it, in my judgment anyway, to be very pronounced with this administration. But it is not new to this administration, and we've had it through our history. I'm not quite sure where it began, why it began, but there is a streak, a dangerous streak that runs counter to the concept of democracy. That we can pronounce that certain people are better than others because they come from different places, because they are of certain religious faiths, because they look a certain way, because they're black or white. And then people in not necessarily political authority, but a kind of cultural political authority, determine that certain people are better than others. And as a kid, I remember vividly radio broadcasts done by Father Coughlin out of Chicago. I lived in New York, but I heard them, and they were virulently anti-Semitic. And I remember asking my parents, how come? Why does that guy have a right to say that? And the answer was, he's got the right to say it. And so he said it. And then you have people today who are saying all kinds of things. I remember reading very recently a report by a KKK group in Virginia, about 15, 20 minutes from here, making very strong points about blacks, nationalism, white nationalism, anti-Semitism. The leader making the comment, which struck me very forcefully, we were able, he said, to rid the world of 6 million Jews during World War II. It shouldn't be very difficult to eliminate 11 million undocumented aliens in this country. He has an absolute right to say that, I think. He says it. So for me, it's the we and them.
For me, it's the demagogic appeal. I have a suspicion that we don't have too many Donald Trump supporters in the room, sort of judging, making an assumption about the audience. Maybe I'm wrong, but I don't think so. I'm a little bit confused about it because I've actually been trying to think of somebody that resembles Steve Bannon in our American past. I thought about Father Coughlin, but I don't think he quite fits. The sort of almost kind of Nietzschean figure who seems to have a great deal of appeal with a certain segment of the public, certainly has a lot of appeal from some very extremely rich backers, but now may have burned his bridges in a reckless gesture, or maybe a recklessly truthful gesture. I can't figure it out. I mean, that's a question that if I were writing about Steve Bannon, I would be looking for a historian, an American historian, to call up and interview on that topic, because I'm not informed on it, and I would like to try to find somebody out there or you historians how to understand and how to judge. But again, for me, what in my sort of clumsy and not very informed way, I'm trying to grapple with the appeal of the demagogic appeal, the nature of the big lie in history. That's a story that I would like to see actually written. How does Trump compare to some of the other great liars of the past? And how do their lies take a hold? How do they get believed? I think about the lie, the Katyn Forest Massacre, which is something that I was reminded of in the days when I used to go to Poland and report on Poland when the Soviets were successful in massacring the cream of the Polish officer corps, and then they mobilized anti-Nazi allied public opinion in order to pin the blame on the Nazis, on the Germans. It was one of the few bad things that the Nazis didn't do, actually. it was the Soviets who carried out that massacre, and it took decades before that big lie was exposed, because it had a lot of appeal. It fit with the dominant narrative. And that's another sort of cautionary thing in my experience that actually it relates to your question It has to do with the dominant narrative. I've done some teaching of journalism in my post-active journalistic years. And one thing that I always have my students do is read George Orwell's Politics in the English Language. And the reason that it's a little bit dated, and I'm not always successful in getting young people to relate to it, but I think for me the lesson in that absolutely amazing article by Orwell is not to allow yourself to be too swept up by the dominant narrative, to question even the dominant narrative. I mean, right now, I'm going to venture out into thin ice. I'm a little bit troubled by the sexual harassment narrative that's dominating the press, including my former newspaper, The New York Times. I think we need to take a closer look at that narrative and to decide whether we're kind of willy-nilly applying stuff that's sort of out there on the shelf of the rhetorical and political culture and applying it to a complicated situation, and whether we need a somewhat more subtle and more politically nuanced and more politically sensitive narrative on that particular issue. Again, I know that's a kind of explosive one at the moment, but I do find myself to be a little bit of a dissenter on some of the ways in which this narrative is being presented. And I think about Orwell and Politics in the English Language and the importance of examining each issue on its own merits and finding the most vivid and accurate and clear, lucid way of presenting that narrative rather than taking off the shelf some of the standard narrative and trying to make the complicated events of today fit with that standard narrative. And that's a very hard thing to do because we live in the moment, and we as journalists are also swept up in the emotions of the time. And it's very, very hard for us as journalists to separate our political opinions, our political emotions, from the way in which we form the narrative, form the story that we're going to tell.
So I do believe that it is our responsibility as journalists to question the dominant narratives that are out there, and partially because we are often the ones that perpetuate them. I think often these narratives come from journalism. Because most of my work is international, the ways I'm trying to do that are to question the dominant narratives of Africa. I contribute to an Instagram feed called Everyday Africa that seeks to do just that, to question this idea of Africa as like the heart of darkness, as a place where there's famine and misery and everything is, you know, everybody's a victim and everybody's poor and, you know, all of these things. So every time I am on the continent, I contribute to this feed and there are pictures of, you know, all kinds of things, but really just daily life and various places that sort of challenge those questions. And I think it's gotten an amazing reception. There's quite a lot of followers, and it's spawned a lot of other everyday feeds and everyday projects and things like that. But I think that's an incredibly important part of what we do.
Obviously, in the introduction, I'm interested in the relationship. I said I was interested in the relationship between the United States and Mexico, and being critical of the going narrative on that. There are many things I uncovered with that work. Two other things that I would point out on that particular case between the U.S. and Mexico. If you live in the Western United States, when was your first African or black president? That would have been the second president of Mexico, Vicente Guerrero. Or who was your first governor of African descent? The last governor of Alta California was Afro-Mexican descent. And actually, as far as voting rights and civil rights, Mexico in the mid-19th century gave voting rights to Native Americans. Native Americans didn't get voting rights in New Mexico and in Arizona until 1948. They lost it in 1848, they got it back in 1948. So to look at Mexico and to see it as a country that's sometimes been ahead of the United States, the way it's seen from the US is always behind its northern neighbor. That's not the case if you look at the historical record. And then another thing for this particular point in time, 2008, just as having been a foreign correspondent and spending a lot of time in other countries, you end up seeing or photographing a lot of coup d'etats and countries that get overthrown and things like that, and you just realize how fragile democracies and governments are and how quickly they can come unraveled. I've seen them fall apart a few times already, and so I think we sit in this country, since it hasn't happened here in a very long time, with this presumption that democracy and governments are much more robust than they actually are. If you look around the world, if you look how fast democratic France can become Vichy France, or other examples around the world, it's worth thinking about.
We have unfortunately reached the end of our session time. I know there's probably still more questions. I'd like to thank our panelists and our audience today for participating in this discussion, and let's give them, all of you, a round of applause. Again, you can find reporting from all of our journalists up here today at PulitzerCenter.org, along with their own websites. I encourage you to check out their work, and if you're interested, we can even arrange for them to come visit your classroom. So thank you.